We have seen that mixtures can be seen as a way to combine simple building blocks in order to make something more complex to achieve more advanced modeling needs. We have seen how to calculate mixtures using Monte Carlo integration. Now I would like to focus on these modeling needs and to say, what do we do with mixtures? In this video, we will use mixtures to perform the same achievements that we did with nested logit models and MEV models. The motivation is that the logit model is based on the assumption that the error terms, epsilon IN, are extreme value, IID distributed, independent, and identically distributed. And we have seen in the context of nested logit model that the independence assumption across I may lead to counterintuitive results. Actually, two things we can do with mixtures is also to relax the independence across I, exactly as we did with logit model, but also relaxing the identical distribution assumption. And in this video, I would like first to look at the first objective, relaxing the independence across I, and we will cover the second one in the next video. To illustrate the concept, I will use an example from an old dataset from the 80s, which was about the choice for local telephone service. And the interesting thing with this dataset is that there were two categories of services which were offered. A flat service refers to a service where you pay per month, a fixed amount, and you can use the service as much as you like. And a measured service is when you pay per use. In this model, we have five alternatives. We have two so-called measured alternatives, and each of them have specific features. The details are not important here. And three flat alternatives, again, with different types of features, which are not important here. And remember, the idea is to relax the independence across alternatives. And this example was selected because we expect that the two measured alternative are actually correlated, so they could go in the same nest if we think about the nested logit model, and the same for the three flat alternatives. The error terms are supposed to be correlated, so they would be naturally going to the same nest in the context of nested logit model. That's basically what I have in mind. So I define two nests, measured and flat, and associate the two measured alternatives to first nest and the three flat alternatives to the second nest. But now, in order to represent this nesting structure, I will use the error component specification in the context of mixtures that I described in the previous videos. In this specification, I have the five utility functions for my five alternatives. I have here the error terms, which are IID extreme value. And now I include one error component per nest. So you can see here, I include the exact same component that is common to the two alternatives in the nest measured. Why? Because in this case, the two error terms, this one and this one, will be correlated by design because they contain both the same error component. And then I do the same for the second nest. I include the same error component in the utility function of the three alternatives belonging to the nest flat. I will assume that these two error components are normally distributed. And in this case, the interpretation of the parameter is that sigma square measured will be equal to the covariance between the error term for BM and the error term for SM. And in the same way, sigma square flat will be equal to the covariance between any two of the alternatives in the nest flat. So here I have used this error component specification to explicitly model the correlation among alternatives in the same nest. But contrarily to the nested logit model, here I have assumed that this common error component has a normal distribution. So this is not a nested logit model. Let's derive the model. So because we have included these IID extreme value error term, conditional to the value of this psi, we have a logit model. So the probability of selecting one alternative, say BM, is given by a logit model. But the xi's are not given, so we need to integrate. So we integrate over Xi measure and Xi flat, the conditional probability multiplied by the density of these error components. And as we discussed at length in the previous video, these integrals can be approximated using Monte Carlo integration. How? We generate draws from the two distributions, normally distributed, and we calculate the mean, the empirical mean of the logit models for each realization of Xi. So let's do it on this example. I have a very simple specification. I have five alternatives. I have included the constant, except for the last one, which is used as a reference. And the only explanatory variable that I have is the log of the cost of the corresponding alternative. And then I have included these two error terms. So Xi M for measured, Xi F for flat. And here are the scale parameters that I have to estimate associated with these error components. The identification of parameters in mixtures of logit model is a complicated topic. I will not go into the details, I refer you to the literature for that, but something that you need to remember is that in this specific model, if I have two nests, only one of the two sigmas can be identified. If I happen to have more than two nests, actually you can estimate all the sigmas, they are all identified. So in this example, we have two nests, so only one of the sigma is identified. So the first thing I've done with this example is that I have estimated a nested logit model with that specification. I have obtained this likelihood function. These are the mu parameters associated with the nest. They are larger than one as expected. And you have here the estimates of the four constants and the coefficient of the log of the cost. And then I have estimated a mixture logit model, a normal mixture of logit, and I have approximated the integral with 5,000 draws. As I mentioned in the previous slide, not all sigmas are identified. So I did four estimations. In the first one, I have tried to estimate the two sigmas. The problem is that because the model is not identified, I cannot estimate two. The convergence of the algorithm that solved the optimization problem was very slow. Okay, so this is not really the nice thing to do. Therefore, I have normalized the model and I have used three different normalizations. In the first case, I have imposed sigma f to be equal to zero. In the second one, I have imposed sigma m to be equal to zero. And in the third one, I have imposed the two sigmas to be equal. So remember, these are normalizations. So the four models, the four mixture models, are completely equivalent. Now let's look at the results. First, I would like to compare the results that I obtained from the logit model and the mixture of logit. Look at the beta cost, for example. So here, I have a value of beta cost, which is minus 149. And here, I have beta cost, which is minus 3.26. This is annoying, because I have used the exact same specification for the deterministic part of the model. The only thing that I have done is that I have slightly changed the assumptions about the error term. I am capturing the same correlation structure, this nesting structure, and I have simply changed my assumption about the distribution of these error terms. And it seems to change completely the value of this parameter. Well, the reason is that because you change the epsilon, the scale of these models is different. If you remember from the first lectures on choice modeling, you have to normalize the scale. But depending on the normalization you do, the values of the beta will change. And here, because we have two different distributions, one is the nested logit model, which has a MEV distribution, as we know, and two, we have this error component specification of the mixture of logit. Well, the normalization that we make from the scale is different. And therefore, you cannot compare the parameters. In order to compare them, what you have to do is to scale them. So one typical way to scale the parameters is to divide them by the cost coefficient. Because if you do so, when you estimate a model, what you actually obtain is mu times beta. Therefore, if in two different models you have two different values of the scale parameter mu, you will have different values of the estimated parameter. So one way to deal with it is to scale the parameters by dividing them by the cost coefficient. Because in this case, the scale will cancel out and you will have something which you can compare. Why the cost coefficient? Because usually this is expressed in currency units, and therefore the quantity that you obtain is also in currency unit. So let's do that. So if I have minus 149, I divide it by minus 149. I have, of course, 1 here. But then I do it for the constant. I have 119 here, 0374, 0344, and 0946. Now let's do the same for the mixture model. Here I divide all the coefficients by minus 326, so I have 1. I have 1.17, I have 0.368, 0.337, and 0.926. Now, if you look at the value of the scaled coefficient, they are not the same, of course. I mean, these are two different models, so I don't expect them to be the same, but at least they are at the same level of magnitude. And this is reassuring. It means that by transforming the assumption I make about the epsilon, well, I keep somehow the behavioral interpretation of the parameters. And you can actually do this, the exercise for all the values here, and you will see that, again, they are basically the same. The second thing I would like to look at is the values of the sigmas here. As I mentioned before, you cannot identify both sigmas. Actually, the parameter that you identify is sigma square F plus sigma square M. Again, I refer you to the literature if you want to understand where this quantity comes from. But the point here is that you cannot estimate the two parameters. The only thing you can estimate is this quantity. And actually, if you calculate it for the examples that I've done, so in all models, here you get 940, 9.15, 9.37, and 9.43. Again, these values are not identical, but they are in the same level of magnitudes. But they are not identical. But these four models are supposed to be equivalent because the only change I've made is just a normalization. So they should be identical. And actually, if you look at the final log likelihood that you find here, this value, and this value, they are different. And again, these four models are supposed to be equivalent because they differ only by the normalization of one parameter. So how come that both the likelihood function and the values of the parameters are not the same? Well, this is where we have to remember that these models, these estimation results, have been generated using simulation, using an approximation of the choice probability. And this approximation was actually calculated with 5,000 draws. So the fact that this is different shows that maybe 5,000 draws may not be sufficient in this case, because we have a variation across models which are supposed to be equivalent. So the variance of the error we make is relatively large. And actually, I have performed another estimation with 50,000 draws. And here are the results, at least for the final log likelihood function that I have obtained. I had -472.872 for the unnormalized model. When I put sigma f equals 0, I have -472.884. When I impose sigma m to be equal to 0, I am -472.901. And finally, when I impose the two parameters to be equal, I have -472.875. So as you can see, the values of the final log likelihood are not the same as we expect. It's still an approximation, but they are way closer. Right, they are in the same level of magnitude. So it seems that we have reached a better level of accuracy as expected when you increase the number of draws. Let's summarize the comments that you have made on these numerical results. First, when you compare two different models, like the nested logit model on the one hand and a mixture of logic in the other hand, you cannot compare the parameters directly. You need to scale them before comparison. Second thing, I introduced this concept of normalization that you have to perform if not all parameters can be identified. And here I compare three different normalization. What I showed, what I illustrated, is that what actually is identified for this specific model is sigma f square plus sigma m square. I noticed as well that the final log likelihood, as well as the parameters, should be the same. But because we rely on simulation, we only obtain an approximation of the log likelihood, and therefore, if the number of draws is not sufficient, we may have large variations across various models, although they are identical. And to show this, I have increased the number of draws, and I've shown that the values that I have obtained were closer to the one that I have generated with 5,000 draws. Okay, so you get the idea. So in order to mimic a nested structure, I have included an error component per nest. But I can use the exact same idea for a cross-nesting structure. So if you remember when we introduced the cross-nested logit model, I motivated the model by saying that a specific alternative may belong to two different nests, which is not allowed for the nested logit model, but it is allowed for the cross-nested logit model. In this example, if you remember, we had a source of correlation due to the fact that the modes were motorized, it's bus, train, and car, and some source of correlation due to the fact that some modes are private as opposed to public. And therefore, the car alternatives could be correlated with the motorized mode as well as with the private modes. How do we do this with the mixture of logit? Well, exactly in the same way using error components. I use the exact same idea as before. I introduce one error component per nest. I have this one for nest one, which is introduced in the three alternatives corresponding to the motorized mode. And I introduce the second error component here in the three alternatives corresponding to the private modes. And actually here, the cross-nesting structure comes naturally by the fact that the car alternatives contains the two error components. Therefore, it will be correlated with the motorized and with the private modes. And then the story is the same. To calculate the probability of car, I have to calculate the kernel here, which is a logit model, and to integrate over Xi1 and Xi2 as we did before. And this is again approximated by Monte Carlo integration. Again, I didn't really talk about identification issues. It's the same as for nested logit. Not all parameters can be identified. And this is a complicated topic. So I refer you to the literature for a detailed analysis of identification issues of mixtures of logits. In this video, we have seen that mixtures of logits can be used to relax the assumption of independence among error terms of different alternatives. Although it is a different model, it achieves the same objectives as the nested logit and the cross-nested logit models. We have made the analogy. Identification issues are complex and have not been covered in this video.